Alors, comme vous le savez, so as you know, 10 years ago, on July 9, 2005, the call to boycott, divestment, and sanctions was launched with the support of more than 170 grassroots Palestinian organizations. At this time, Palestinians called upon their allies to boycott Israeli products and to refuse all collaborations with Israeli-sponsored institutions and events until Israel complied with three demands, namely ending the occupation and colonization of Palestinian lands, ending institutional racism against Palestinian citizens of Israel, as well as respecting the right of return of Palestinian refugees in the diaspora. Over the past decade, the movement has gained considerable momentum, becoming global in scope and gaining the support of many sectors, from academia to the arts, from churches to community movements. Among its many victories include the withdrawal of companies such as G4S and Veolia from long-standing contracts, the cancellation of concerts by high-profile artists such as Lauryn Hill and Thurston Moore. Divestment actions on the part of European banks as well as major U.S. churches. As well as direct actions such as blocking Israeli boats and Elbit factory shutdowns in the United Kingdom. Montreal has also seen its share of achievements in BDS organizing over the past decade. A number of resolutions have been adopted over the years by unions such as the Canadian Union for Postal Workers and the CSN. Student associations including ASSE, as well as community groups such as the Fédération des Femmes du Québec. In February 2010, the Montreal Artist Declaration was launched with the support of more than 500 local artists. More recent, in the last year alone, a BDS resolution was adopted here at Concordia by the Concordia Students Union. While the Now shoe store was forced to close as a result of PAJU's ongoing picket, and a new cultural boycott campaign was launched demanding that the Cirque du Soleil refrain from performing in Israel. Such efforts have served to challenge Israeli impunity as well as the state and corporate complicity that enables it to continue. In many respects, it also serves to isolate Israel and to exert pressure upon it. In the last year alone, foreign direct investment has dropped by an estimated 50%. While a recent RAND report suggests that Israel could lose $47 billion in the next 10 years as a result of their occupation. In many respects, this speaks to the extent to which BDS has exerted pressure on Israel and rendered the occupation increasingly unprofitable. At the same time, Israel continues to intensify its regime of occupation, settler colonialism, and apartheid. Palestinians continue to resist displacement in the Nakab, home demolitions and denial of residency in East Jerusalem, settlement expansion, as well as the expansion of the apartheid wall. It's also important to note that 1 year ago today, Israel launched Operation Protective Edge in Gaza, killing more than 2,200 Palestinians and wounding more than 5,000.
If you're going to be stopped, you're not going to successful.
We're coming in them, not you.
While we have a great deal to celebrate, we still have much work to do. So, with this in mind, we still have much work left to do and many questions left to ask. We are looking forward tonight to an evening of critical reflection around the boycott divestment movement. We'll have speakers who'll be speaking to successes and setbacks that the movement has encountered, as well as current challenges and future directions for the movement. This brings us to our first speaker of the evening. So, Samia Al-Batmeh is a visiting Palestinian professor from Birzeit University. She is on the steering committee of the Palestinian Campaign for the Academic and Cultural Boycott of Israel, one of the founding civil society organizations of the BDS movement. Please welcome Samia Al-Batmeh.
Thank you for coming out this afternoon. It's an honor to be speaking to you about BDS, our campaign, which has now been running for the past 10 years. BDS is the campaign that...
Okay, let's go.
Our campaign has now been running for the past 10 years. This campaign was initiated by the Palestinians in response to...
Racist sign is about to go.
I'm actually honored to have our friends here. I've never seen this level of desperation before. So. With the moral support coming from the back, and you know, we're all enjoying this evening, so thank you very much for all the lively show. Okay, back to our campaign, which is trying to end Israel's settler colonialism in Palestine, as defined by the Palestinians around three main rights. That's what the movement stands behind. It stands behind the end of the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, equality for the Palestinians living inside Israel, as well as the right implementation of the right of the return for the Palestinians. It's a movement that tackles the entirety of the Palestinian people. It doesn't just focus on the 39% of the Palestinians who live in the West Bank and Gaza Strip. Why did we innovate this campaign at this particular time? We did that given Israel's continued viciousness, Israel's continued settler colonial policies, ethnically cleansing the Palestinians of the land, confiscation of resources, driving the people, killing people, imprisoning, destroying livelihoods. This has never ceased or stopped despite all the agreements before and after the peace process. There is also the fact that the Palestinians have engaged the Israelis over the course of the past 30 years in both informally in terms of civil society, including the academia where I come from, as well as on the official level in terms of the agreements that were signed by the PLO and Israel. These agreements, because they were built on the non-recognition of Israel's colonialism, Israel's entrenchment of the occupation, basically ended up giving legitimacy to Israel's colonialism on the ground. There is also the role of the international community that saw the Palestinian question as a natural disaster, and therefore poured in aid to the Palestinians, which at best enabled us to survive colonialism and cope with colonialism rather than end colonialism. And in a way, we were treated as a group of beggars who are starving and hungry for aid in, you know, in the form of dried eggs and dried milk coming from Europe and the rest of the world. Since our question is political, since our rights, right to self-determination is taken by Israel, that's what we brought back to the scene through developing the BDS movement. So it is about asserting the rights of the Palestinians, but it is also about addressing the symmetry in power between the colonized and the colonizer, the oppressed and the oppressor, in a manner which recognizes these two parties for what they are. We have also devised this movement learning from the Palestinian past experience. We have engaged in boycotts during the British Mandate period. We have engaged in boycotts during the First Intifada. And then learning from international experiences, as in the South African case. So we brought all of that and we tried to bring a consensus around it through civil society and build the movement both locally and internationally. Today, what we will try to do briefly, myself and my other two colleague speakers, is to cover different parts of this movement in terms of its successes, in terms of what it has tried to do, and how successful it was, and where we're going, and we're taking it further. The movement has built itself internationally, actually magnificently, over the past 10 years. And, you know, thanks to Israel's viciousness, actually, we're grateful in that respect. Thanks to Israel's viciousness, the manner with which it masked its own face of being a very oppressive colonizer that invaded and intruded on lives so viciously. It actually helped the movement grow internationally in a record time. As a result, there has been BDS groups across all continents. These groups have been working diligently to campaign around BDS in all areas, be it economic, academic, cultural, or in the area of sports. And these groups have been working to bring about education on the Palestinian issue, the manner with which it focuses on non-racist resistance, on non-violent forms of resistance that try to end Israel's colonization. The building of this movement is actually thanks to the Palestinians in Palestine, but it's also thanks to conscientious individuals and groups like yourselves around the world who made this happen. So thank you on behalf of the Palestinian people for all your solidarity and support, which made this movement into what it is today. The movement, again, I'd like to repeat, because that's very significant for us as Palestinians, bringing us back to the basics of what we stand for when we talk about Israel's colonialism and broadening the rights of the Palestinians to encompass all segments of the Palestinian people, has been a significant achievement for this movement. And we have been very much attacked, actually, particularly by the Israeli left on including the Palestinians inside Israel, as well as the refugees, because these are segments of the Palestinians that even the Israeli left is trying to eliminate out of the colonized Palestinians. So bringing these segments back into what it means to be Palestinian has been another important achievement for this movement. Unmasking Israel in front of the eyes of the world for what it is. Israel has always marketed itself as being a liberal democratic state. A liberal democratic state that actually discriminates against its own citizens. There are more than 40 laws that discriminate between the Jews and the non-Jews inside Israel. These have been actually recognized by the American Foreign State Department. To that extent, the Americans have even been recognizing that. So the fact that it actually discriminates against its own citizens is a form of apartheid. Its policies in the West Bank and Gaza Strip, in terms of restricting the movements of the Palestinians, in terms of the destruction, in terms of the wars, repeated wars on Gaza, and the loss of life that has taken place there. All of these incidents Israel used to whitewash abroad through marketing itself as a democracy, as protecting itself from the vicious Arabs. The BDS movement has actually unmasked all of that. It has helped educate people, and it has unveiled and shown clearly what Israel stands for and the practices that it carries out against the Palestinians. What the movement has also done, which is extremely valuable, is provide the Palestinians with hope. And that's the Palestinians inside Palestine, but also internationally. It is very important for you to know and for us to communicate to you how significant is your work to our lives, to our everyday lives in Palestine. It actually empowers us. It enables us to challenge and resist Israel's colonialism on everyday basis. So do not underestimate your activities, no matter how trivial they seem to you. The boycott of Israeli goods and commodities, promoting BDS on university campuses, getting your church group or your trade union or professional association to divest its pension funds or investments from Israeli companies or companies that are engaged in the occupation. All of these activities impact our lives directly and are a source of empowerment and are a source of hope to continue with the liberation process and resisting colonization. So please do not underestimate, no matter what, your activities and your actions in solidarity. One point that I'd like also to emphasize with this respect is the long-term process of our struggle. Our struggle is a struggle that will take years. And for that, it is important to strategize. Strategize in a manner that actually builds up mass support and mass mobilization on the ground. Engaging in one campaign or one set of actions by itself should only lead to another. And therefore, the manner with which we approach campaigns should take that into account. The successes that Amy has gone through are a testament to the manner with which the BNC, the BDS National Committee in Palestine, and PACB, the Academic and Cultural Boycott Campaign, together with partners around the world, have strategized over the years to bring about these successes. And the strategies that were followed focused mainly on attempting to educate and mobilize with whatever people were able to, or whatever people selected, depending on their own context. And the results were amazing in terms of how many university campuses were able to pass motions in solidarity with BDS. How many trade unions around the world how many trade unions have actually succeeded in supporting the Palestinians. There has been also support coming from church groups, support coming from other segments of civil society. Now, this was the initial phase of the BDS movement. This has translated into a different level later on, and that level is basically governments. And now we see, for example, the Norwegian government divesting from Israeli companies. We see financial institutions that are extremely conservative. Banks are actually taking a position against Israeli banks. Even banks in Germany have been divesting from investments in banks, in Israeli banks. So in a way, that shift in the activities and in the operations of the movement from mass mobilization on individuals and civil society level to the, in a way, the second tier of formal official institutions as well as governments has been a significant contribution to pressure on Israel. And actually, this pressure has been mounting from various angles. Lately, this has also been something that the Palestinians have worked on, the BDS movement has worked on in the past 5 years. The Arab governments, the Kuwaiti government lately has listed 50 companies, international companies, that it excluded from its portfolio of investments and engagement in Kuwait because of their role in aiding Israel's occupation. Also, the Kuwaiti government has withdrew an investment for Viozia with the amount of $750 million. Because of its involvement in the occupation. So this sort of work of trying to get formal institutions and financial institutions and large companies to take a stance in addition to civil society, in addition to individuals and households, has been a significant progress in the movement. Now, what are we doing in terms of the future? We are building on this base, and we are building towards creating more mobilization and more solidarity on the ground. I've spoken to some of you before, and many of you, or some of you, pointed out that many do not know about the BDS movement. And that's legitimate in the sense that it is a movement in the making. So our role, in a way, that gives us scope for the future to expand our role and work diligently to create a truly a mass movement. And this mass movement is to ultimately impact policy makers and ultimately impact decision makers, i.e. governments, to pressure Israel. So once we have built this mass movement. Is it? Am I not loud enough? So once we have built this mass movement against Israel's viciousness and colonialism, we hope for the change. We hope for the decolonization of Zionism and ending Zionism to liberate Palestine.
Why don't you say Jews?
Actually, Israel has lately been informing us that we have become very successful. So it has been sending us signs and confirming our I'm talking about the, a bit of higher authority than our friends there, the Israeli government, actually. So the Israeli government has been telling us in so many ways that we've been doing very well. And, you know, being a teacher myself, that's very informative and that's very useful. They've been telling us that by issuing, actually, statements about the dangers of the economic boycott. Ministry of Finance, for example, Reut Institute, all have been formulating reports about how dangerous is the economic boycott. Israel is an open economy. That diversification is useful and important. But also, that means it is vulnerable and exposed to the rest of the world. And that gives us power. And we are using this power. But we need to... And we want to strengthen this power and push it forward. Israel's passing of the law to criminalize BDS within the Knesset is another indication of its desperation and its incapacity to deal with this form of resistance. Its attempts to try and negotiate with the EU and the Americans over trade clauses that exempt the settlement goods and commodities from entry or from being actually excluded from trade has been another signal for how desperate Israel is in terms of its incapacity to handle BDS. So we seem to be doing something right, Israel is telling us so, and therefore we need to push forward. I just have a few words more to say about how we see the future in a way in coming from Palestine and how we can push forward the campaigns. The campaigns around the world have been individual in nature, and that's the sort of that's normal in a way given the startup process. Converging these campaigns is very useful. And here I'll use the example of Veolia. Veolia was able to be targeted here in the US, here in North America, in Europe, in the Arab world. And this is how Veolia lost. It's through this concerted effort that came together from across the world that made Veolia lose. The same with G4S. G4S is the British Belgian security company, is now being targeted from across the world. And these campaigns bring about these huge multinational organizations that are involved in atrocities, that are involved in undermining the rights of the Palestinians. So working within these campaigns is one powerful tool to bring about education about the Palestinian context, but also to pressure Israel. The government, the Canadian government pension system, has been investing in Israeli companies. And that's a campaign that can actually be conducted here in Canada from different angles, from different localities, be it in BC or Alberta or Quebec, to convince the Canadian government that it is important to actually stick to ethical investments. And Israeli companies and Israeli and companies that engage in Israeli occupation are involved in violating the human rights of the Palestinians, and therefore that should not be encouraged, and that should not be promoted. Working together, students and activists on the ground, academics, has been another model that we're trying to push forward, because there has been these separate campaigns bringing together groups that can mount larger campaigns is the way forward. And ultimately, our objective is to impact governments. So, we need to continue with our mobilization, and we need to strengthen this mobilization depending on context and depending on what sort of targets we use. But it is very important to know that this campaign is, or this movement is growing. And by its growth, we hope that liberation is brought forward. And thank you very much.
So thanks again to Samuel Bartman. Next, we would like to welcome Zahia Al-Masri. Born as a Palestinian refugee, Zahia's work and activism centers mainly around the areas of social justice, intercultural communication, and peace building through recognition. She has mediated and participated in numerous interfaith, intercultural roundtable discussions on conferences on the question of Palestine. Zaha holds an MA in Public Policy and Public Administration, as well as a graduate diploma in Theological, Religious, and Ethical Studies. She currently works at Ramel, an organization specializing in social housing for immigrants and cultural communities. She is also a member of BDS Quebec. Please welcome Zaha Al-Masri.
Bonsoir tout le monde. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out here, especially on a beautiful summer day like we had. Even though it was raining, it was still beautiful. We take what we can get. Like Amy mentioned, first of all, thank you so much, Samia. Under all this pressure, you demonstrated Palestinian powerlessness. Like Amy mentioned, I was born as a Palestinian refugee in Lebanon. Now, I don't know how many of you, I see a couple of faces actually who were born as Palestinian refugees, and it has a particular impact on your life, whether it's your daily life, it's your family life, it's your life when you go to school, it has an impact on everything. My dad was forced into exile in 1948 during the Palestinian Nakba. Now, he wasn't alone. Over 700,000 Palestinian refugees were exiled, and they all went into refugee camps. I don't know how many of you have visited refugee camps. I'll just give you a description of what it feels like to live in a refugee camp. First of all, you have no infrastructure. Second of all, you live in a refugee camp in a state of temporary. Everything is stuck in time, because one day, we're gonna go back. And that one day has turned into years and decades. And what's the sad reality of Palestinian refugee camps, and I can speak of Palestinian refugee camps mostly in Lebanon, is that there are generations and generations being born into the life of a refugee. So you have your dad who was a refugee, who's living in the camp, you're born as a refugee, you're living in the camp, and your children are born in the refugee living in the camp. Amy mentioned that I work here in social housing. So as many of you here, we have social housing programs in Quebec. We know what an issue that is. Now take that and transfer that situation into a makeshift camp that was first built with whatever stones they may have been able to found, under what tents. So if we go camping here in Quebec, we go luxury style camping. We have all our kits, we're equipped. It's not the same in a camp. So keep on picturing that. You have makeshift camp, makeshift tents, you have makeshift homes, and they have been building homes for generation onto generation into these refugee camps. Now, Palestinians living in Lebanon don't have access to over 20 professions. They can't buy land. Even if they do go to school, they can't work in their profession. They have schools that are financed by the UNRWA. They can go to private schools if they can afford it. Having said that, even if they have access to education, their future, they've seen what the past generations have been through. They don't have a very bright future ahead of them. They see what they can accomplish and where the limitations are. These are Palestinian refugees living in Lebanon. Now take Palestinians who are living inside the Palestinian territories, Palestinians who are living inside Israel, who live in unrecognized villages. Now just hearing the term unrecognized villages takes me to the time when we first came into Canada and they couldn't, you know, we have our visa, and they asked my dad, where were you born? And he said, Haifa, Palestine. And they said, we don't have a category for Palestine. So what did they put on his visa application? What did they put? They said pirate. Under my dad's application, visa application here in Canada, my dad is listed as a pirate because he's from Palestine and he was born there. So this is the sort of events that kind of always, always catch up with you wherever you go. The first thing that you are asked, what are you? Palestinian. Palestinian, Palestinian. I've been here for 30 years, and the first time they asked me that question, Palestinian, Palestinian, and they weren't quite sure. Africa, where do we exactly situate this? And when you hear that, it hits you. It's a profound, profound, profound insult to your essence, to your existence. Now, saying this and then linking that to a national struggle, everybody says, well, you know, these are personal things. It's not a personal thing. This applies on every Palestinian person. Our identity is always in question. However, the entire international community today is looking at Palestinians and seeing the people and recognizing the Palestinian national entity in its own self. And this is part of what the BDS campaign has been able to accomplish, whether it's on the inside or the outside. I just want you to take a look at the back and see that this is what Palestinians, for example, in Hebron have to put up with on a daily basis, with their kids outside or not even being able to play outside because of this sort of pressure and intimidation that they try to exercise. So if Palestinians in Hebron aren't going to put up with this, nor will we. So, just to go on, I wanted to highlight a bit of the successes that the BDS campaign in Quebec has brought. So I'm just going to name some of the organizations that are part of BDS Quebec. CSN Quebec, Syndicat des travailleurs et travailleuses des postes, Centrale des syndicats du Québec, FNEC, Fédération nationale des enseignantes et des enseignants, Conseil central du Montréal métropolitain, Conseil régional FTQ du Montréal métropolitain. Le groupe FRAPRU, Ligue des droits et libertés, Fédération des femmes du Québec, Association syndicale pour une solidarité étudiante, College and University Workers United, Graduate Students of Association of Concordia, Entraide missionnaire, Centre justice et foi, Alternative, Comité de solidarité Trois-Rivières, Réseau uni pour la justice et la paix en Palestine et en Israël, Forum musulman canadien, Présence musulmane, Palestiniens et juifs unis, PAJU, Tadamon, SPHR, Groupe Rezek Farage, Un seul État, Voix juive indépendante, Comité de solidarité pour la paix en Palestine, UQAM, Perspective palestinienne, Regroupement des Algériens et Algériens du Québec, Québec solidaire et le Parti communiste du Canada. So this is... great accomplishments that should be highlighted. What's great about BDS is that it's not a movement that applies only to Palestinians. If anybody who wants to end complicity with Israel's violation of international human rights, they're doing it because it applies to international law. And it's not in itself a heroic act. It's a moral and conscious act that applies to every person, to every human being. It does come to help Palestinians, the ending the occupation and the colonization, but it's a conscientious, humane act first and foremost. And this is, again, something that has contributed to the strength of the BDS movement all over. Now, going back to the life of refugees and Palestinian refugees and the right of return, one of the things that we ask for is the right of return, is to put in place the right of return, to guarantee the right of return to every Palestinian refugee and to every Palestinian. This is something that applies to all Palestinians, and this is something that we ask for. Why the right of return? Because whenever you ask for a place to belong to, that's the first thing that's asked for. And Palestinians don't ask for much. Today we are asking, as Edward Said, for less than 20% of what belongs to us first and rightfully. So this is the only thing that we are asking for. Now, all of the peace efforts have failed. And this is one of the movements that have accomplished the most throughout the entire Palestinian struggle. And as Samia pointed out, this is something that's been ongoing with the Palestinians since the 1920s. I visited Palestine in 2004. And during my visit, and this is something that I'm extremely proud of, during my visit, I went to the Aqsa Mosque. And there was a demonstration there of women who had a lot of people who had prisoners in Israeli prisons. Most of their kids were imprisoned there. And I saw this one lady, and she was carrying several pictures of her sons and daughters who were imprisoned in Israeli prisons. And I just saw her, and she was there, you know, demonstrating peacefully. I had my son, who was 4 years old at the time, with me. And I saw her, and I saw the other moms, and I obviously got emotional, and I brought my son, and I held him, which is something that I thought these women can't, you know, can't do. Imagine going to bed at night knowing that because in Israel, for example, they give lifetime sentences. So any Palestinian prison, even if they don't know what they are being imprisoned for, can get, I don't know, 2 lifetimes, 3 lifetimes in prison. So a mother doesn't have access to her child even to make sure that they're okay, even though they're in prison, just to make sure that they're okay or to even see them. But I went to her, you know, and I held my son close to me, and then I couldn't, you know, it was my first visit to Palestine because I had gotten my Canadian passport, and I started crying. And she comes over and she looks at me. I thought she was going to comfort me, which is normal. And she comes over and she starts basically yelling at me, you know, and telling me, what are you doing? And she overtook me. I said, well, you know, it's just a very emotional situation. I see you with the pictures and see the other mothers with all the pictures. She said, no, you shouldn't cry. Because the only thing that I am asking for, and all Palestinians are asking for, is what is rightfully ours, is what international law recognizes as our right. And this is a Palestinian woman who has given seven of her children to the cause, and she's saying it. So this goes back to the idea of hope. One of the things that I kept with me most of all of my visit there and of all of my conversations that I have with my aunt and uncles in Gaza and in Nablus is this idea of eternal hope. And it's not hope because we're just hopeful people based on nothing. It's hope based on right, on the idea. It's a rights-based approach that this is rightfully ours and one day we will get it back because it is our right. And this is what they strive for, and this is what they work for. And believe me, going back there is always, always, always an inspiration, even talking to them. During the most recent Gaza war, I was talking with my uncle there, and yes, I mean, his house has been demolished twice, and right now they're living in the rubble around their house, because in Gaza, contrary to public opinion, there is no reconstruction in Gaza, in spite of what all that has promised. There is no reconstruction right now in Gaza. Right now it's the month of Ramadan and people are having their iftar and eating at night outside in the rubble. But this is a normal situation they have gotten used to it, although it's far from any normal standards, yet they have gotten used to it. So whenever I speak with him, this is a situation that they say, sooner or later, it will end. Sooner or later, this is something that will come to an end, and they are extremely convinced of that. This is why the idea of upholding the right of return for all Palestinians is extremely important. And highlighting that this is one of the BDS demands also is something of great importance. One of the things that I also wanted to highlight is that the narrative of the Palestinian people is one of demanding recognition, but it's never demanding recognition by negating somebody else's existence. And although it's portrayed that way, that's something that always should be repeated and kept in mind. Never did we ask for recognition for what's rightfully ours by negating the existence of somebody else's. That's never been what we request for. What we ask for and what's rightfully ours is the right of return and the right for refugees, the right for Palestinians living under occupation. Basic human rights, basically. This is what Palestinians are asking for. I was talking to you about there's a Middle East exchange program at the University of McGill, ICANN. And the executive director right now, her name is Amal Snoun Hajouj. And she's a Palestinian from the Naqab area. And she always speaks about the unrecognized villages. Now, on its own, that term reaches the core of me in terms of what does it mean to have an unrecognized village. You have people living there, You have children attempting to go to school. They've been there for since as long as they can remember, generations on end, yet they're still unrecognized, and there's still a plan in the works to populate the area, yet they're still unrecognized villages. And she speaks about all the attempts that they are trying to do to have these villages recognized. But what's remarkable about her narrative is this discussion, this openness to a negotiation between Palestinians living on the inside and the Israelis. After a while, there is a way that they have to meet halfway in order to talk. And this is another way that inspires us and gives us hope, because there are things that are being done by civil society groups on the inside of Israel, by Palestinians and Israelis, and inside Palestine, and on the outside as well. So this is something also that's very important, and it supports as well the BDS movement, because it does come and gives this extra strength for Palestinians to demand what's rightfully ours as well. Just on a closing note, I wanted to highlight that all the work that's being done here by activists in Montreal and in Quebec around the BDS, I know that there's a statement that was signed by artists against apartheid, and it was led by Kadamon and by Stefan particularly. That should be honestly highlighted and applauded as well. And I know that all the talk about the flotilla to Gaza also helps in informing people about the situation and letting them know what's going on. So that's also great. And I don't have the latest news. I don't know if any of you have the latest news of what's going on, but I haven't been up to date today. But it's extremely important for us to keep up to date with this information. So all of this just goes to reinforcing what Palestinians are asking for and the right to return. It's one of the most basic human rights, to belong to a place that you feel that is home. And this is a right that we are denied on a daily basis, just to go home, basically.
So our next speaker has been involved in Tudamin since 2005-2006, and has been one of the main organizers, was one of the main organizers who brought to life the first BDS conference in Montreal in 2010, and was involved in building the foundational elements that paved the way for BDS Quebec. A community organizer with the Immigrant Workers Center, Mustafa Hanawi, was based in Montreal until 2014 and is currently living in Berlin. He is the author of the zine Capitalism on the Edge, The Crisis That Came and the Crisis Yet to Come. Speaking as a member of Tudamin in Exile by video, Mustafa's talk will likely focus upon his admiration for Yanis Varoufakis and possibly on Montreal-level BDS organizing as well.
Thanks, everybody, for letting me speak tonight. Obviously, I'm not in Montreal with everybody. I wish I could be there. And unfortunately, I get to do the second best, which is to participate via Skype. And unfortunately, I won't be able to participate in a really critical discussion or to be able to hear the two other speakers, which I would have really loved the opportunity to do. But again, really thank everyone in Tudamin for letting me give my thoughts or reflections in regards over BDS over the past decade, in regards to some of our victories, but also some of our challenges that we actually face. And in regards to looking back over the last 10 years and thinking about our victories, I think we have to see our victories not just in sort of a quantitative measure, but we also really need to look at the victories of the BDS campaign qualitatively. How did we actually change the discourse of Palestine solidarity organizing? How did we change the discourse in the public about Israeli apartheid, or even placing Israeli apartheid within the mainstream discourse? And I think for me, that's the foremost, I think the greatest success and one of the greatest victories that we've been able to achieve over the past decade. And I think it happened quite rapidly, even though the discourse of apartheid had been within Palestine organizing, whether it be in the 60s and 70s, whether it be Israeli academic writers in the 80s, the fact that Israeli apartheid as a discourse became so prevalent after the campaign for BDS was launched. And I think what it achieved was that it shifted the discourse actually from being one of just simply anti-occupation, which was prevalent in the Palestine Solidarity Movement during the Second Intifada, because it was so based within the West Bank and within Gaza Strip, that most of the focus and most of the energy was around ending the occupation. While there was much criticism around why aren't we talking about the Nakba, why aren't we talking about the right of return, as being the fundamental core issue to Palestinian resistance and to any justice within Palestine. And I think with the Israeli apartheid analysis and the call for BDS and those three demands being inseparable, ending the occupation, the right of return, and ending discrimination against Palestinians living inside 1948, that those three fundamental core pillars and ending those injustices would lead to an end to Israeli apartheid, full self-determination and equality for all Palestinians, regardless inside 48, inside the occupied territories, or inside the or on the outside in the diaspora. So this was fundamental, I think, about the call for BDS, that it gave a broader framework and a tool for activists and organizers to use within the West. And this shift actually led to putting Palestine on the map more broadly. I think back before 2005, before the call was made, when we were organizing against the invasion of Iraq, there was quite a bit of resistance to actually to add Palestine or even any discussion about Palestine onto the foreground of the anti-war movement, leaving it a shallow analysis of the Middle East and what was actually taking place, and what justice in the Middle East actually meant. That for many people, having an analysis that was broader than Iraq, why the U.S. was invading Iraq, why the occupation was taking place, and putting a regional analysis that also put Palestine at the foreground was critical, but that was left to the side because it was too controversial. And I think, again, the strategy of BDS and activists, once the call was made, was really to put Palestine on the map. And I think this was an incredible victory not very long after, despite the tremendous effort of Palestine Solidarity activists before the call was actually made. I think the other set of victories, particularly for us in Montreal and Quebec, that we've achieved that may not be seemingly quantitative, but is actually quite significant if you add it up, is the amount of public support we've been able to gain for the call of BDS. And going back from 2006 to 2007, the workshops we did with ASSE, to getting ASSE on board, being the first student union in North America to actually endorse the call for BDS, to the FFQ endorsing the call for BDS, FENEC, the Quebec Teachers Federation, and then eventually leading to bigger organizations beginning to support the call for BDS. Quebec Solidaire, at their conference of almost 3,000 delegates, supported it almost unanimously. Conseil Central of CSN endorsing the call for BDS in 2010. And then now eventually, going towards 2015, we see CSN, the second largest trade union federation in Quebec, finally endorse the call for BDS. The formation of groups like KUU, College University Workers United, which brought together academics from all four universities in Montreal and beyond, to begin to organize around the academic boycott, to the endorsement by GSA and CSU at Concordia, to the part-time student workers at McGill. The list of endorsers have been endless, not to mention the 500 artists who signed a letter after Operation Cast Lead, calling for boycott, divestment, and sanctions. And that's quite more significant than artist letters that have been produced in other cities, such as the one in Ireland or UK, the fact that 500 artists in one city have declared their solidarity with the Palestinian struggle through BDS is quite significant, and it shouldn't be underestimated. And we can see that reflected in regards to the actual to our demonstrations and to the urgent calls, such as last year during the massacre of Palestinians, of over 2,200 Palestinians in the Gaza Strip. And I think the other kind of victory that we need to celebrate is the diversity of campaigns that we've had. And again, this may not be a quantitative achievement, but it's been critical to understanding the breadth of the BDS movement, of Palestine Solidarity Organizing in Montreal, whether it be the consumer boycott and the demonstrations and actions against the Haba in front of the bay, whether it be the campaign to make apartheid free, Rue Saint-Denis, timeless, bi-weekly pickets by PAJU, and now the campaign against the Sabra Hamas is another clear example of the breadth of the consumer boycott, Chapters Indigo. So the pressure that's been leveraged in regards to institutions or businesses that are supporting Israeli apartheid have been consistent and resound over the past 10 years. Also the SAQ and the boycott of Israeli wines made from the occupied Golan Heights. In regards to the cultural boycott, the campaign against Cirque du Soleil, actually severing Cirque du Soleil's ties and asking them not to play in Israel, was a critical a letter or campaign to show that Montrealers and Quebecers actually don't want their institutions to be supporting apartheid. Campaigns across campuses such as Technion to end any support with an institution that's quite embedded with the Israeli military and embedded within the Israeli apartheid system is a critical campaign in regards to the boycott, the academic boycott within campuses across Montreal, particularly at McGill and Concordia. So the breadth of campaigns have been tremendous in regards to Montreal, in regards to Quebec, in regards to not just being done one by one organization or one by one collective, but whether it be PAJU, whether it be KUWU, whether it be TADAMIN, whether it be the trade unions on their own accord, whether it be through BDS Quebec, whether it be through Independent Jewish Voices, the fact that we've had so many organizations and so many institutions outside of the Palestine Solidarity Movement has been actually been able to achieve quite a bit in regards to pushing BDS at the forefront of Quebec society. And I think this has been really an achievement by, one, getting mass-based support, but then also the breadth of campaigns that we've been able to launch within Montreal over the last decade. In regards to some reflections, in regards to that success, I think it's really important to recognize one of the more critical points. In 2006, during the first BDS conference that was held in Toronto, Jamal Juma from Stop the Wall campaign had spoke and was talking about some of the earliest victories, especially with the Norwegian pension funds, and saying where BDS had actually been the most successful and been able to accomplish the most, it's due to its rootedness within other social movements. And I think we really need to take stock of that lesson and of that reflection, and how much that is based upon the successes we've had in Quebec. It is because of the strength of progressive social movements or mass-based institutions or the politics of particular trade unions that we've been able to garnish that support for BDS and for Palestine Solidarity more broadly. And I think it's really critical that when thinking about BDS, not over the past 10 years, but for the next 10 years, the more and more it mainstreams, the more and more I think we have to be focused and aware that we have to maintain that anchor within different social movements in Montreal and Quebec for Indigenous sovereignty, for ecological or climate change, justice, around anti-austerity movements, that we have to put Palestine within those frameworks, in a broader framework, for liberation and social justice. And I think that's going to be a tension that we're going to have to deal with the more and more BDS, becomes more and more mainstream. But we can see that impact, even on our own movements, not necessarily as BDS as a tactic, but actually what we were able to achieve last summer, in regards to just the diversity of tactics. The fact that we were able to have demonstrations, not just from St. Catherine, to Barry UQAM, but the fact that we had a 6-hour night march, circling Montreal time and time again. The fact that every Wednesday, we had an evening demonstration, at Metro Mont-Royal. The fact that we had a demonstration in, Ville Saint-Laurent. The fact that we were able to mobilize people and have demonstrations, in Rosemont Petit Patrie. The fact that we learned from the student strike in terms of where we have our demonstrations and the different tactics that they took on, had an impact on the way we built our movement and sense of urgency around what was taking place in Gaza, this past summer. And I think it gave the energy, that was really needed, to have such a strong movement, in response to Israeli aggression and Canadian and Quebec complicity, on the massacres that took place in Gaza. In regards to another reflection, I think that we have to be aware of in regards to as BDS becomes more and more mainstream, I think it's critical that we don't actually lose sight of the three principles of BDS, and that those demands should never be separated. I think the more and more popular it becomes, as discussions around the settlements or discussions around Gaza in particular, we begin to lose sight of the picture, and not only do we begin to lose sight of the picture, but we begin to lose the arguments that we have with people who maybe oppose BDS, because then you're talking about a framework that no longer exists, even for the American state. Obama talks about a two-state solution. The Israeli left talks about a supposed two-state solution. And that's clear. That a two-state solution doesn't actually, will not happen and will not exist, because what we're seeing is Israel has full control, territorial control, over the entire historic land of Palestine. And so that we get trapped in a discourse that doesn't actually offer any alternatives or any solutions or what the Palestinians themselves are demanding. So I think it's critical that we don't separate the demands of BDS, and that we stay the course in regards to actually focusing on the right of return, full equality for Palestinians inside Israel, and an end to the occupation. Because once we pick them apart, I think we lose the arguments in the public discourse. In regards to some of the challenges, and I'm going to have to go through this quickly, I think that we face are paramount. I think last summer we saw such energy, thousands of people mobilized, in the face of a massacre that Palestinians were facing, people wanting to show their solidarity and people not knowing how, while we presented BDS as one tactic or as one strategy for people to express that solidarity. But the problem is that it happens in that moment. And I think we see this time and time again. After the Israeli war in Lebanon, after Operation Caslet, after last summer, all of a sudden, there's this whole new layer of society that wants to participate in what we're doing, and then BDS became one of those tools or one of those tactics, but we haven't been able to channel that energy into any broader campaign or any broader organizing with the same sense of urgency in the long term. And I think for us, that's a real critical challenge that we actually have to deal with, in regards of building BDS over the next 5-10 years. It's not that there's people who want to support or play a role, but the question is, how do we actually channel that energy with the same sense of urgency during these crises to be able to build really mass-based and strong campaigns? And I think there are some of those key points that I think we can really hit on being in Montreal and Quebec, and it's a challenge. I think this is the second challenge is, well, what to boycott? It's not Europe in regards to the amount of produce, the amount of consumer goods that come from Israel into North America. And so it's a bit more difficult in terms of the cultural boycott. There's not those same types of links that exist within Europe and Israeli apartheid. But I think we're able to have a few key points that I think that could really make for strong BDS campaigns. And I think one of them is actually Montreal-based corporation CAE. Many people who know CAE, it's one of the largest defense corporations in the world and one of the largest corporations in Quebec, actually won a $100 million contract, not just for supporting the Israeli Air Forces, other criminal institutions like the American Air Force, NATO, but in particular, CAE was awarded contracts for the Israeli Air Forces and for Elbit Systems for training simulators for its drones to test its drones in Alma, Quebec. And this is not a small contract, and it's not a small role. It's not simply complicity on the level of political statements, but it's the fact that a Quebec corporation is giving the means for Israel to carry out atrocities on an unprecedented level. The fact that a Quebec corporation has trained those pilots that dropped those bombs on Gaza, it's a responsibility for us to make sure that that can't happen. And I think that campaign could give us quite a bit of tools, whether it be from direct action, whether it be from academic institutions, through secondary boycotts or secondary divestment campaigns. It's hard to boycott a military corporation. I mean, no one here buys a drone or no one here buys a tank, maybe. But the fact is that we can use secondary boycotts or secondary divestment campaigns to force CAE to drop its contracts with Israeli apartheid. The CAE have contracts with research institutes, with universities in Montreal and Quebec. The CAE recruit on campuses for engineers or for staff. So I think it gives us a lot of room in regards to actually pushing forward a meaningful boycott that can move from just simply political support for Palestine and trying to end political support for Israeli apartheid, but to one that can concretely actually isolate Israeli apartheid and particularly isolate any support for the Israeli military carrying out its atrocities. And I think the second challenge that we actually have to face is that the more and more BDS becomes mainstreamed, and the more and more the breadth of the movement is actually the fact that we're seeing the Canadian state veer completely the other way. It's not simply that they're buckling to pressure from our movements, but they're becoming staunchly more and more Zionist. And it's particularly due to the pressure, the fact that the Israeli state, Israeli politicians know that there's been little to no public support or ground for what it is carrying out, that it's finding a sense of desperation and finding the last legs it can stand on in the international arena within the current Canadian government. And that's been clear. And the Canadian government has made absolutely no apologies about its staunch support for Israeli apartheid. And actually, even in the crown speech of Stephen Harper last year, talking about Canadian values, he primarily focused on staunchly supporting Israel, that we are not going to be simply friendly to make friends, to essentially that we won't appease public opinion or popular opinion because we know we're standing on the right side of justice by supporting Israeli apartheid. And I think the fact that we have a government that has made such a clear stance, I think gives us an opportunity to challenge them on their position. But I think also we have an opportunity and an obligation in Montreal, because regardless of who wins the elections next year, no one is going to backtrack on the commitment the Canadian state has made in supporting Israeli apartheid. What the Canadian government has done is what New Zealand, what Israel had done to support South African apartheid, to be the last staunch ally. I think we now see that the Canadian state is trying to play that similar role. And I think we have a kind of an obligation, whether it be to end the Canadian-Israeli Free Trade Agreement, the Quebec-Israel Accords, to end Canadian complicity by returning the money back to UNRWA, to returning back the funding that was cut off by the Palestinian Authority, or cut off to the Palestinian Authority in the Gaza Strip by the Canadian government. We have an obligation to end and to besiege the Canadian state's position, and not just complicity, but its active support for Israeli apartheid. And I think those challenges are critical ones, and obviously there's no easy answer, but I think with the amount of support we've been able to build over BDS over the last 10 years, I think we'll be able to actually to channel those energies, not just to politically isolate Israeli apartheid, but to actually begin to concretely isolate it and isolate anyone who tries to profit off of Israeli apartheid and its crimes against the Palestinians. So hopefully in the next 10 years, we won't be talking about symbolic victories anymore, and we won't just be talking about atrocities, but we'll actually be able to talk about victories, about on the march forward to ending Israeli apartheid, and the kind of movement we need to build to do that, and to stand in solidarity with Palestinians who are actually doing that. Thank you, everybody, and let's celebrate 10 years of BDS, because the effort we've all put in has been tremendous, and I think we're beginning to see the impacts of the kind of movement we've built over the past decade.
Sorry, and the second thing is, along with BDS Quebec, we are initiating a campaign against the military ties between Israel, Canada, and Quebec, and our universities. And Mustafa mentioned CAE. Also, Technion is a Israeli company that helps oppressed Palestinians in Gaza especially. And they have ties here at Concordia and ties at McGill. And I think also U2M. So I'll hand out a flyer on that. I don't know if BDS Quebec has anything on that right now. But just to let you know that there's stuff going on here that we can participate in. And that's all I'm going to say about our stuff. And I think Sabine or someone. Yeah, well, one more action actually that is by the PAJU, which is Palestinian Jewish Unity, is organizing, and we have a weekly picket on 2 days, at least until the end of Ramadan, in front of Adonis in Atwater. And it's Friday from 12 to 1 and Saturday from 1 to 3. And it's because Adonis, all Adonises actually are selling Sabra hummus, which is produced by the Sprouts Group, which supports the Israeli army financially. So this hummus is in particular is not made, the one that they have in Israel, it's actually made in New York, but they support financially, and they say it openly on their website, that they support the Israeli army, the IDF, with financial support for the soldiers, and they give them food vouchers and stuff like that. So we are hoping that, you know, the population of Montreal will be able to put enough pressure on Adonis, especially because they produce their own hummus, so there's absolutely no reason for them to sell Israeli hummus, that we would be able to mount enough pressure for them to pull it off the shelf. So hopefully we can see you all there.
I'd like to ask you to take note that there will be a Palestinian march for cultural identity on September 27th, beginning at Metro Montreal, going to Parc Chamonix. Tariq Taha is the initiator here. And
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. You know, maybe it's a little bit early, but I'd like just to mention a little bit about it. This march will be organized in three different cities here in Canada. Will be here in Ottawa and in Toronto. Okay, the objective of the city is to give a better image about Palestinians' history, cultures, and food, music. So our objective was to do a marathon, but it was very hard to get the permit from the city of Montreal. So they asked us for many conditions, and it was very hard for us to do it. So we decided to do it as a culture march, which will start at 11 o'clock at Metro Montreal, and inshallah we'll go marching until Jan Mans Park. At Jan Mans we'll have music, we'll have dance, we'll have a defile, a Palestinian dress culture show. We have many, many surprises this day. Okay, to register for this march, you need its registration fee, which is $20 for students, $25 for non-students. You will get in exchange a Palestinian t-shirt, a Palestinian cap, water and juice. And the rest of money will be divided among five local associations, including Montreal hospitals, Saint Laurent soccer teams, Medical Aid for Palestine, and a homeless group working here in Montreal. So to follow up, just go to Facebook at Palestinian Culture March, and inshallah we hope to see all of you during this day. Thank you.
Hi, I'm from SPHR McGill. Right now we're actually working on a joint BDS project with Concordia. It's an academic boycott of the Technion, and we're working on that with students, both undergrads and grads from both schools, as well as professors and a few workers. The Technion is a university in Israel that does a lot of research that has direct applications in the West Bank. It's mostly research of, or a lot of research of military technologies. And there are ties with the Technion and both McGill and Concordia. So if you're at either of those schools, either as an undergrad or a graduate student, or in any other position, and you're looking to get involved, that's something. Or also, if you just want to join either SPHRs, we're both doing lots of work this year, so get in touch. And I have a sheet here that I will be passing around if you're interested in doing so, or you can just come talk to me. So thank you.
Thank you. So this brings us to the question and answer period. Before we begin taking questions, just a couple of basic guidelines. First of all, we would just ask that you try, if possible, to maybe formulate your intervention in the form of a question. In the interest of everybody having the chance to speak, we'd also maybe it would be great if you could also maybe keep your question to under 1 minute if possible. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, go ahead.
I just want to congratulate you for your steadfastness for having been able to cope with these settlers here. But what I want to ask you is, how do you do that in real life? I mean, we've been colonized now for over 65 years, and that has targeted our lives and livelihoods. But it has also targeted our capacity to continue with the struggle. And this is actually what Sharon said in the 50s, that the Palestinians, you know, Israel has just to worry about the initial 20 years, i.e. the generation that was ethnically cleansed in 1948. And then later generations will forget about Palestine. That's what he said in the 1950s. And now we are in 2015, and Palestinian generations after that are still true to the cause, are still struggling and resisting. What we are resisting for is our rights. And this right does not die by the passing of years. And no matter how many years will pass, we will devise forms of resistance. And we will continue as communities in Palestine and in the diaspora till liberation is attained. And that's something that is part of who we are as Palestinians and part of how we live our lives. And what we are striving for is humanism and our right to exist and survive. And without attaining that, we can never stop. And that's what drives really every Palestinian. Our lives are not easy, we struggle. I was born under occupation, so for me what was behind is an everyday occurrence. It just happens a bit more violently at home. And that, what it actually reflects on us is how is the significance of the resistance and not accepting Israel's colonialism and not surviving this colonialism, but actually challenging it and aiming to end it. And that's what BDS does. BDS, it enables us as Palestinians to practically transform our feelings of frustration, of oppression, of in a way survival of this colonization project into a way to resist it and end it. And in a way, we have been doing that for the past 10 years. And it is very heartening to see how people around the world, institutions, civil society, social movements have come to stand in solidarity with us. And we believe that's principled solidarity in the sense that it does not enable us only to survive colonization, but it actually enables us to challenge it and hopefully end it in the near future.
Hello. I was wondering what kind of solidarity work could be done in Latin America as far as opposing the apartheid that Israel has created for the Palestinian people. I know that currently Venezuela is bringing Palestinian refugees to Venezuela to study medicine and offering them I think, political asylum. What do you see the efforts of the BDS movement in Latin America to be critical to the liberation of Palestine? I know that Israel is helping build a wall between the U.S. and Mexico, and so I wanted to know if you like the ideas of Venezuela and the Chavismo and the socialism, and do you think that the Chile has just recently divested from Palestine? Do you think that the Latin American people could be some sort of critical catalyst to your movement?
Okay, I'll address that quickly. Latin America is highly significant for standing in solidarity with the Palestinians. We have actually come to work with Latin America late, only since about 5 to 6 years. Now, Latin America is also targeted by Israel because it's rising economies. It's like the case of India. We've been having dialogue with the Brazilian government, who has been opening up more towards Israel because of economic links. And therefore, we have been trying to target more and more through the solidarity movement there, governments to continue with their stance of solidarity with the Palestinians, because historically, Latin America has had a very positive stance towards the Palestinians. So there has to be a challenge to these tendencies, i.e. Israel coming to dominate, in a way, dialogue with governments in Latin America through its economic and security ties. Now, how this can be done? It can be done through the solidarity movement there, and therefore strengthening these, diversifying the campaigns. We've been lately trying to convince the ex-minister of culture in Brazil, Gil, who's going to sing in Israel. And this is somebody who is behind a grassroots land movement in Brazil. These are social, progressive social movements that have influenced the lives of peasants in Latin America. Now, these social movements, or you know, individuals leading them, are coming to sing in apartheid Israel. I mean, how paradoxical that is. So we're trying to converse with him, and it's difficult, actually. So there has to be pressure coming from the ground within Latin America to, in a way, translate the forms of political solidarity that have been theoretical in nature, in the sense that we stand with the Palestinians, we support the Palestinians. That has to be translated from our perspectives as people engaged in the resistance at the moment into solidarity actions. And we have defined, as the colonized people, the form of solidarity we want. We do not want charity. We have, in a way, had charity for the past 65 years, and we have seen the impact of charity. What we want is political solidarity. That can be in the form of training doctors in Gaza. That helps the steadfastness of people in Gaza. But also, that means pressuring Israel. And pressuring Israel is refraining from cooperation with Israel, be it at military level, be it economic, be it academic, or cultural. And therefore, there has been this difficulty, actually, in Latin America. How do you translate sentiments of solidarity into practical steps? That's what we are currently trying to work on with the solidarity movement. But the significance of Latin America is certainly clear, given its history of struggle, given its the diversity of social movements and its capacity to impact the rest of the world.
Just on this, my name is Sabine Friesinger. I've been involved in Palestine solidarity work for a while. I'm just wondering, I think it's a question I'm posing to the room and also to the panelists, and kind of in line with what Samia was hinting to now, and I'd like you to elaborate more in terms of here, our work. We see many, you know, after 10 years, I guess, when the call first came out 10 years ago, we were like, I think everyone was like, oh, where can this go? Is it, you know, and now 10 years after, we really see that there's actually a huge impact, and especially hearing it today here. But what I'm wondering is, in our work, in our solidarity work, should BDS not be the kind of thing that we all converge towards in terms of solidarity work on Palestine at this present moment? So, for example, how do we make initiatives like things like the Flotilla, which is amazing in terms of visibility and so on the conditions of Palestinians, but how do we make this work and converge towards the BDS movement? How do we make other initiatives, you know, all sorts of solidarity initiatives converge towards this? How do we as BDS activists intervene in those spaces and help to broaden our movement even on further?
I mean, activities have to, in a way, educate about Palestine. So not every action needs to be, you know, BDS-based. Education is highly significant, and highlighting the plight of the Palestinians inside Israel, you know, what's happening at the moment in Al-Araqib, in Naqab, is a process of ethnic cleansing in the making. And it has been ongoing for 65 years. This village has been rebuilt, Al-Araqib, more than 50 times. Israel destroys it. The Palestinians in the Naqab rebuild it. And that is the story of Palestine. And these are citizens of Israel. And the plight of Gaza, the destruction of lives, the killing of lives, and the killing of every prospect for future life, highlighting how Israel restricts the entry of goods such as chocolates, for example, because that's threatening to the security of the state of Israel in Gaza when the Palestinians eat chocolates. You know, these extremely perverse forms of restricting the lives of the Palestinians just for the sake of it. How I am here in Montreal, while I was not able to enter Jerusalem for the past 6 years, although I live just 15 minutes away from Jerusalem, all these aspects of our lives in Palestine and highlighting these and the apartheid structures, the women giving birth at checkpoints, I work a lot with statistics being in my subject, and always we have for giving birth, it's the only place on earth where women categories for giving birth are hospital, home, and checkpoints. So if you look at Palestinian statistics, you find that. And you know, the likelihood of babies surviving after women have given birth at checkpoints, you know, is minimal. So bringing that into light, how our students, I mean, I walk into my classes every day, and the first thing I think about when a student is absent, are they in prison? Because students get picked up at checkpoints every day. When he or she will turn up? And that's, in a way, an everyday activity of trying to seek education. So everything about our lives is harsh. everything about our future, Israel tries to kill off hope. The destruction of the Palestinian community in Jerusalem through physically ethnic cleansing people from Jerusalem, but also through starving the Palestinians from work, through circulating their livelihoods so that they would leave Jerusalem, the uprooting of trees, what it means to villages waking up in the morning who have been waiting for a season of, say, a crop of olives or fruits to, you know, pay their school and university fees, and find all these trees have been chopped off. What does it mean to people's lives? All of these facts and how people have to survive house demolitions, how children, when we pass checkpoints, I find it difficult to explain to my nieces and nephews why checkpoints exist, why we can't, they always ask me, why can't we go to Yaffa? We smuggled ourselves once a few years back. And why can't we just go to Yaffa and, you know, swim in the sea? The sight of children seeing the sea for the first time in their lives when they're 12 and 13 years old is astonishing. So just bringing all these everyday narratives to people around the world is significant. And that is the basis, that is the first step to explaining then what do you do about it? How do you accept it? Do you think it's ethically acceptable that people around, people in Palestine live such lives? And the means that one can then engage in changing this reality. The flotilla, how can one, in a way, make it a tool of BDS? By basically highlighting the fact that the flotilla stands behind the full rights of the Palestinians. I mean, I don't know how much you know of that debate, but the last flotilla, a couple of years ago, we have had a huge debate between a group of Americans and us within the BDS movement about the rights of, about the flotilla standing behind the full rights of the Palestinians. And at the time, it was argued that, something that Mustafa talked about, it was argued that in order to make the flotilla more popular, it should only challenge the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza Strip. And therefore, that should be the highlight of what the flotilla is standing for. And we objected in Palestine. We objected strongly by saying that does not represent us. That actually represents the Israeli left. Because the stance of the Israeli left is to challenge the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza Strip. So if the flotilla is standing with the Palestinians, is trying to empower the Palestinians, stand in solidarity with the Palestinians, then it should respect how the Palestinians define their struggle, and therefore stand in solidarity with the three rights, i.e. ending the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza, the rights of the Palestinians inside Israel, and the rights of the Palestinian refugees. If it only limits itself to ending the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza Strip, then it's actually standing in solidarity with the Israeli left and not with us. And this is how a totally non-BDS activity like the flotilla, which is extremely important, can contribute to promoting, I mean, BDS is a tool, it's not an end by itself, it's a strategy. But this is how it can contribute to the liberation process, by respecting, by standing truly in solidarity with the Palestinians. So it is not, in other words, it is important to engage in any activity possible Like in Germany at the moment, there are a lot of activities that are extremely educational in nature. We haven't yet got there to the level of trying to run BDS campaigns on the ground. But that's significant, that's important. Dealing with the context of wherever we are in the world. In Japan, the campaigns are very different in Korea than in South Africa. In South Africa, we are asking the South African government for a stance, and the South African government is responding. In Korea, we're dealing with the situation differently. So this diversity and the capacity of BDS to, in a way, acclimatize itself to whatever context there is very powerful. So as long as we stand with the political rights of the Palestinians and we try to do whatever it takes to bring that about, that by itself is engagement in BDS movement.
So we're going to take another 2 to 3 questions before we wrap up for the evening. I think we have one we have one here in the front.
Hello. I'm Dr. Abraham Weisfeld. I'd like to state that I endorse the BDS campaign, not only for the products that are coming from the occupied West Bank, but from the Zionist State of Israel as well, as we need to all. And of course, the campaign that was initiated in 2003 against the Jewish National Fund, so-called, by Dr. Uri Davis, who is now a professor at Al-Quds University in Jerusalem, is also a campaign that should be endorsed as well as the right of return of the Palestinian refugees, considering that I myself am a Jewish refugee from post-Holocaust. Now, the question is, how to strategize the BDS campaign. Now, we have been able to be fairly successful in the BDS campaign, getting endorsements and various concessions by various companies internationally. And this indicates that we are on a good path. Now, these successes of the BDS campaign so far have been outside of the control in those areas of general society that are not under control of any Zionist institutions. Now, the two areas that are very strategic and that are important to defeating Zionism, of course, are within the control of the Zionist institutions. Now, I take responsibility for combating the Jewish National Fund within the Jewish community, which I'm trying to speak to the Jewish people directly who have not heard anything that we've heard here today. They've only heard the Zionist side, so they have to be addressed from within the Jewish community. And the question that I have, that I want to pose to you, is what is being done and what can be done for the BDS campaign within the Zionist State of Israel, other than the occupied West Bank? I know Omar Barghouati is inside Israel, but to what extent has there been actually organizing within to boycott, you know, products from Israel and to prefer those products that are coming from the West Bank?
And then we'll just take one more question here in the front.
Thank you. I understand that the BDS activists are several groups worldwide. I'm really addressing those in Quebec here or in Canada. Is there any group that is challenging Bill C-51 that's trying to criminalize BDS? I'm just concerned that if one day somebody is arrested because of a BDS activism and he is going to have to fight justice by himself, is there a project to contest the law C-51 for its constitutionality in the courts before anybody is hurt?
I'll respond to the first question, and maybe Zahia can respond to the second one, since I'm not very familiar with the Canadian terrain. In terms of what's happening inside Israel, I mean, there is a boycott from within, which is a couple of conscientious Israelis who are in solidarity with the BDS, and they try to work from within Israel. There are very few. Their role, though, is significant in the sense that they have recognized the rights of the Palestinians as defined by the Palestinians, not as defined by the Zionists. And they are responding to our request in terms of using BDS as a tactic. There is also BDS guidelines for Palestinians inside Israel. How can Palestinians not help normalize Israel's colonialism, having, you know, lived a different reality from those in the West Bank and Gaza Strip? So as the BNC, the BDS National Committee, has been trying to address the different Palestinian communities and enable them to challenge Israel's Zionism, even those who are living in Israel. Paradoxically, actually, what BDS has done is engage the mainstream Israeli society with a dialogue. We always hear that BDS, or particularly academic and cultural boycotts, result in a way, alienating the Israeli society from engaging with the Palestinians. And as a result of boycotts, actually, this engagement has been more intensified, because for the first time, Israeli mainstream had to answer to its actions. So boycotts have encouraged dialogue, but have encouraged dialogue on the rightful terms. Before, dialogue, especially by the international community, has been propagated along the lines of, you know, there is a conflict in Palestine between two groups over land. And these groups are assumed, the Palestinians and Israelis, are assumed to be equal. And therefore, they should engage in a dialogue to resolve their issues. That's the terms upon which the peace process has been constructed. And we all know the repercussions of the peace process. BDS does engage the Palestinians and Israelis in a dialogue, but it engages the Palestinians and Israelis dialogue upon rightful terms that the Israelis are colonized and the Palestinians, the Israelis are colonizers and the Palestinians are colonized. And therefore, the aim is to address the imbalance in the power relations rather than assume that this imbalance does not exist. And I mean, it is a process. We're told in South Africa that the white South Africans claimed that they didn't know what was happening to the blacks. And we actually hear that a lot coming from the Israelis. So BDS is bringing it to them. You know, this is what you're doing. These are what your soldiers are doing to the lives of the Palestinians. But here there are sets of privileges. I mean, why would a privileged group give up its privileges? History teaches us that the only way a privileged group would give up its privileges is through pressure. Slavery wasn't ended by convincing slave masters of their wrongdoing. Colonialism around the world was not ended, British colonialism was not ended by the Queen waking up and realizing, wow, it's actually atrocious to colonize India. It was pressure, it was resistance. And that's what the Palestinians are trying to do, trying to mount pressure on the Israelis through the Palestinians in Palestine, be it those living inside Israel or in the West Bank and Gaza Strip, but also through collective efforts internationally. And that is your role that you have played very, in a way, conscientiously in the past 10 years. And we hope we can rely on your solidarity and support till liberation.
Regarding the C-51 bill, it's great that you mentioned, you brought that up. I think it's something that concerns all of Canadians, not only the BDS movement. And I know that there's been a lot of talk around it, and it's good because it's gotten our government to talk about BDS and its impact, who Bill C-51 really targets. As regards to the BDS movement, as I said, I know that there's some things that are being discussed, but I don't know if there's anything yet that's been working, that's being worked on. What's important for BDS also is to focus its efforts. And I think collectively all organizations should be targeting Bill C-51. I know that there are some people here who can address the issue of Bill C-51 because there are some of the groups that are working on it, like Lorraine, if you want to take Lorraine.
Sur C-51, à peu près tout ce qu'il y a d'organisation au Québec, mais tout ce qu'il y a d'organisation syndicale, communautaire, de défense des droits, la Ligue des libertés, les droits et libertés, ont fait des positions très solides sur ces questions-là. Ils vont contester cette loi-là, entre autres dans la période électorale, en faisant un enjeu électoral, poussant les
candidats et tous les partis qui vont se présenter à récuser le Bill C-51. Sur la question de BDS particulièrement, il y a une entente qui a été signée entre Israël et le Canada en janvier dernier, disant deux choses. Considérant que toute critique d'Israël est une forme de nouvel antisémitisme, et deuxièmement, criminalisant la campagne BDS en particulier. Alors, à ça, à l'initiative de Voix juive indépendante, il y a une pétition qui a été signée, il y a une trentaine d'organisations québécoises qui l'ont signée, une soixantaine dans l'ensemble du Canada. Et là, la seule réponse à cette intimidation-là, ça a été de dire « Nous allons renforcer la campagne BDS ». C'est la seule...
has to be contested in constitutional court. I was in politics, okay? Petitions has to do with votes. You have to go, this is an anti-constitutional remark. I know our member of parliament in the town of Mount Royal, Irwin Cutler, has been working on that criminalization, that any form of criticism of Israel is a form of anti-Semitism because you're not giving the right of Jews to have their own land. And this has to be contested in constitutional courts before anybody gets hurt.
No, absolutely.
So this brings our event to a close. I just wanted to start by thanking Samia and Zafia and I'd also like to thank the Concordia Student Union, without whose support this event wouldn't have been possible. Thank you also to our allies from SBHR McGill, SBHR Concordia, PAJU, RADLAW, and Justice for Palestine for their support of the event. And also to all of you for your support and solidarity in spite of the presence of some decidedly less than ideal backup dancers.